on the rejection of the bill for abolishing the slave trade, 1791 cease, Wilberforce, to urge thy generous aim. Thy country knows the sin, and stands the shame. The preacher, poet, senator in vain has rattled in her sight the negro's chain, with his deep groans assailed her startled ear, and rent the veil that hid his constant tear, forced her averted eyes his stripes to scan. Beneath the bloody scourge laid bare the man, claimed pity's tear, urged conscience's drunken rule, and flashed conviction on her shrinking soul. The muse too, soon awaked, with ready tongue at mercy's shrine a plausive paean rung, and freedom's eager sons in vain foretold a new Astrian reign. An age of gold she knows and she persists still. Afric bleeds, unchecked, the human traffic still proceeds. She stamps her infamy to future time, and on her hardened forehead seals the crime in vain. To thy white standard gathering round, wit, worth, and parts and eloquence are found in vain, to push to birth thy great design. Contending chiefs and hostile virtues join, all, from conflicting ranks, of power possessed to rouse, to melt, or to inform the breast where seasoned tools of avarice prevail. A nation's eloquence, combined, must fail each flimsy sophistry by turns they try, the plause of argument, the daring lie, the artful gloss, that moral sense confounds, the acknowledged thirst of gain that honor wounds bane of ingenuous minds, their unfeeling sneer, which sudden turns to stone the falling tear they search assiduous, with inverted skill, for forms of wrong, and precedents of ill, with impious mockery rest the sacred page, and glean up crimes from each remoter age wrung nature's tortures, shuddering, while you tell, from scoffing fiends bursts forth the laugh of hell. In Britain's senate, misery's pangs give birth to jests unseemly, and to horrid mirth. Forbear thy virtues but provoke our doom, and swell the account of vengeance yet to come, for, not unmarked in heaven's impartial plan, shall man, proud worm, contemn his fellow man and injured Afric, by herself redressed, darts her own serpents at her tyrant's breast each vice, to minds depraved by bondage known, with sure contagion fastens on his own, in sickly languors melts his nerveless frame, and blows to rage impetuous passion's flame fermenting swift. The fiery venom gains the milky innocence of infant veins, there swells the stubborn will, damps learning's fire, the whirlwind wakes of uncontrolled desire, sears the young heart to images of woe, and blasts the buds of virtue as they blow. Low, where reclined, pale beauty courts the breeze, diffused on sofas of voluptuous seas, with anxious or her menial train around catch her faint whispers of half-uttered sound. See her, in monstrous fellowship, unite at once the Scythian and the Sybarite, blending repugnant vices, misallied, which frugal nature purposed to divide. See her, with indolence to fierceness joined, of body delicate, infirm of mind, with languid tones imperious mandate surge, with arm recumbent wield the household scourge, and with unruffled mien, and placid sounds, contriving torture, and inflicting wounds. Nor, in their palmy walks and spicy groves, the form benign of rural pleasure roves, no milkmaid's song, or hum of village talk, soothes the lone poet in his evening walk. No willing arm the flail unwearied plies, where the mixed sounds of cheerful labor rise, no blooming maids and frolic swains are seen to pay gay homage to their harvest queen. No heart-expanding scenes their eyes must prove of thriving industry and faithful love, but shrieks and yells disturb the balmy air, dumb sullen looks of woe announce despair, and angry eyes through dusky features glare. Far from the sounding lash the muses fly, and sensual riot drowns each finer joy. Nor less from the gay east, on essence twings, breathing unnamed perfumes, contagion springs, the soft luxurious plague-like pervades the marble palaces and rural shades, hence thronged Augusta builds her rosy bowers, and decks in summer wreaths her smoky towers, and hence, in summer bowers, art's costly hand pours courtly splendors o'er the dazzled land the manners melt. One undistinguished blaze o'erwhelms the sober pomp of elder days, corruption follows with gigantic stride, and scarce vouchsafes his shameless front to hide the spreading leprosy taints every part, infects each limb, and sickens at the heart's simplicity. Most dear of rural maids, weeping resigns her violated shades, stern independence from his glebe retires, and anxious freedom eyes her drooping fires. By foreign wealth are British morals changed, and Afric's sons, and India's, smile avenged. For you, whose tempered ardor long has borne untired the labor, and unmoved the scorn, in virtue's fasti be inscribed your fame, and uttered yours with Howard's honored name. Friends of the friendless hail, ye generous band whose efforts yet arrest heaven's lifted hand, around whose steady brows, in union bright, the civic wreath and Christian's palm unite your merit stands. No greater and no less, without, on with the varnish of success, but seek no more to break a nation's fall. For ye have saved yourselves and that is all. Succeeding times your struggles, and their fate, with mingled shame and triumph shall relate, while faithful history, in her various page, marking the features of this motley age, to shed a glory, and to fix a stain, tells how you strove, and that you strove in vain.